हेलो सर 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 यू आर इन म्यूट कंडीशन।
Yeah, can you hear me now?
यस सर यस सर
Okay, hi. Yeah.
वेलकम सर।
Yeah. Can you see me now?
यस सर।
Okay, cool. Just one second, let me talk. I'll just try to share my screen to make sure there's no problem.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Okay. Window. Can you see it now?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
All right, I'll move one slide forward. Let me know if that happens.
Yes, sir.
All right, we're good. Okay, so I will now unshare. Okay. Okay, very good.
Okay, sir, we will be starting at sharp 4 p.m.
All right.
The participants are joining and okay, all right. We are waiting for our advisor to join.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
So we will be starting at 4:05 because the participants are joining still now.
Yep.
So that's why we are waiting for the.
All right.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Okay, sir, sorry for the inconvenience. Sir, are you there?
Yeah, go ahead, sir. I muted myself. Please go ahead.
Okay, okay. Thank you, sir. Okay, so hello, everyone, and welcome to today's live webinar on new system design challenges in implementing full duplex communication in next generation wireless network, which is organized by IEEE Computer Society Student Run Chapter, IIT Kharagpur. I would like to introduce our speaker today, who is going to talk to us about the topic. So let's welcome Dr. Nilesh B. Mehta, sir, and he is a professor in the Department of Electrical Communication Engineering at the Indian Institute of Science, IISc Bangalore. He received his BTech degree from IIT Madras in 1996 and his master's and PhD degree from the California Institute of Technology, USA, in 1997 and 2001, respectively. From 2001 to 2007, he worked in the USA at AT&T Research Labs, Broadcom Corporation, and Mitsubishi Electric Research Labs. His research focuses on the design, modeling, analysis, and optimization of current and next generation wireless systems. He is a fellow of the IEEE India National Science Academy, INSA, India National Academy of Engineering, INAE, and National Academy of Sciences, India, NASI. He is a recipient of the IIT Roorkee's Khosla National Award in Engineering, Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award, Hari Om Ashram Pratit Vikram Sarabhai Research Award, DST Swarna Jayanti Fellowship, and NASI Scopus Young Scientist Award. He currently serves on the steering committee of the IEEE Transaction on Wireless Communication and on the IEEE Comsec Award Committee. He served on the Executive Editorial Committee of the IEEE Transactions on Wireless Communication during 2014 and 14 to 17, and was its chair during 2017 to 18. He served as a board of governors of the IEEE Communication Society from 2012 to 2015. So please join us welcoming our today's speaker, Dr. Nilesh B. Mehta, sir. Thank you, sir, for joining us, and I would like to request our participants to keep your mic and camera off, and please don't share your screen in between the session. And also, we would like to share that we are also live streaming in our YouTube channel and Facebook page. So those who are joining us through our YouTube channel and Facebook, they can use the chat box to ask your question. When our speaker will be done, he will answer all of your question. And those who are in the Google Meet, please use the chat box to ask your question. We will deliver the question to our speaker. And also, please do not, it's a request, please do not post anything irrelevant other than the topic questions. And thank you. And our team is there, our IEEE Computer Society Student Run Chapter team, constantly monitoring everyone in social media and our Google Meet also. So don't worry, your question will be answered. So stay with us and enjoy the webinar. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Can you hear me, please?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let me share my screen. Just hold on. Yeah, we just tried it 5 minutes back, but now there's a circle showing up. 1 second. Yeah. Oh boy. Looks like the application is going to crash. Just give me a minute. I'm sorry.
But yes, sir. It happens.
Most likely it's going to crash. Okay, I'm going to rejoin. Let's just save time.
Yes,
please. Close the program. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Very good. Okay, now let's do the next step. Look at that. Sorry, this exactly when things go wrong, they go wrong. All right. Okay. Yeah, should work now.
Yes, sir. It's coming.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Now it's clearly visible.
Yes. All right. Yeah. So, well, thank you so much for the invitation and for the nice introduction. And thanks to everyone for joining. Let me get started. What I'd like to do is talk about some, give you a fairly high level overview of an interesting topic about an emerging technology that's full duplex convenience that's being fairly actively considered for future wireless systems. It's currently not there in most practical wireless systems, but it's one of the key things people are looking at. So what I want to do is convey to you why people are excited about it, and also why there are some new problems that arise. And anytime you have new problems, it's good, because then I have a job. So that's basically the goal of the talk. And I should mention, this is essentially work done with my students, Ramakiran, who's a senior PhD student, and he's looking for a job now, he's about to graduate, and Justin, who was a former MTech student. In a nutshell, if I were to motivate full duplex, this is the figure I'd use. And essentially, if you look at today's systems, let me turn the pointer on. Yeah, they are what are called half duplex systems, which means that you can either transmit or receive, but not do both simultaneously. And that's why it's called half duplex. Okay, so for example, today's cellular systems, they call themselves full duplex because you can transmit and receive at the same time, but don't send it on the same band. So they use a different frequency for uplink, which is transmitting to the base station, and a different frequency for the downlink, which is receiving from the base station. So they do not transmit and receive at the same time on the same band. What full duplex promises to do is that it promises to enable transmission and reception at the same time on the same band. And you can see why this is exciting in a way, because fundamentally, two things can happen in parallel as opposed to only one. So if we talk about spectral efficiency, which is how much data rate you can transmit per unit bandwidth, you've essentially doubled your spectral efficiency. And that's why it's a technology of relevance to the future. But if you want to look at the future, let me just put it in a little bit of context, which is essentially the context of 5G and also beyond now. People are also talking of 6G now, for example. So if you look at 5G and beyond systems, they are not unidimensional systems. They are designed for many different use cases, and they have many different goals. And I'll tie the full duplex to these goals very soon. But broadly, some of you would have seen this, some of you not. So let me just take a little time on this. There are three broad categories of services that they're going to tackle. One is what's called enhanced mobile broadband, which is basically 4G on steroids. So you're just going to get much higher data rates, higher spectral efficiency, and so on and so forth. So just a much better, stronger 4G system. But they're also trying to do what is called massive machine type communications to support IoT. So applications include handling remote sensors, actuators, monitoring for factory environments, and so on. So here the difference is that we're talking of large number of devices of the order of 1 million devices per kilometer square being connected to the network. And the third new thing, and which is also a very, very new thing, in fact, is ultra reliable low latency communications, where they're talking of very, very high reliability. Reliability usually has not been a forte of wireless systems. And that's why it's not been adopted widely, for example, in factory automation type systems. But now they're going to go after that, and that's the new frontier. They're looking at very reliable systems and with very low latencies. And obviously, this has many, many applications. And if you go to the web, you'll see many, many exciting applications of this. So if you look at the broad goals, you'll see goals like spectral efficiency, which EMBB goes after, latency, which URLLC goes after, energy efficiency, which is a broad goal anyways, you have to go after it regardless of what you do, and reliability. So there are multiple goals, multiple services. And there is this alternate way this is described using what's called a spider chart. There's a very famous diagram of about 5G, and it shows a lot of things in a way, remarkably compact and natural manner. So what is shown here is a circle, three concentric circles. I'll walk you through this. The lowest circle means low priority, middle circle is medium priority, outside circle is high priority or importance. Okay, and then you will see these edges here. These are the properties you want to go after. So like spectrum efficiency, mobility, peak data rates, energy efficiency, connection density, like how many users you can connect, latency, and so on and so forth. And what I spoke about, enhanced mobile broadband, machine type communications, ultra reliable low latency, they're here. And each of them goes after a different envelope of properties, if I can use that word. So for example, if you're looking at enhanced mobile broadband, it wants very high spectral, it puts a lot of importance on spectral efficiency, a lot of importance on peak rates, capacity, energy efficiency. Whereas ultra reliable low latency says, it's okay if you compromise a little bit on data rate, peak data rate, but I really do want very low latency. So latency is really important for me. Machine type communication says, I want to be energy efficient. I don't particularly care about your data rates, but I do want very high connection density. So each one has its own profile. But the important thing to notice is, I've circled four things. All four of them have something or the other to do with data rates. Spectral efficiency, higher data rate, higher spectral efficiency. For example, full duplex doubles it. The data rate experienced by users, both at the cell center and cell edge, area traffic capacity, essentially is also a measure of how many users you can support in a cell. Latency, all of these things, full duplex promises to improve them, or in the case of latency, reduce it, which is also an improvement. Okay, so full duplex ties in very nicely with many of the goals that 5G systems have, or beyond 5G systems will have. So that said, what I'd like to do today is a couple of things. One is bring attention some new challenges that arise when you make full duplex happen. So what does it take to make, why is full duplex a new technology? Why is it not there in the 1980s, for example? You can ask this question. It's a very natural thing to do. Why didn't we do it till now? And then once I highlight the challenges, I'll show how they force you to redesign or revisit the way you do cellular system design, the way you do Wi-Fi, wireless LAN design. And it's quite interesting. And here is where, for example, Ramakiran has worked on. And then I'll summarize and give you the key takeaways. Okay. Now, regarding questions, I would suggest the following. There are three, four natural points where I can stop in the middle of the talk. I can stop and then I can take questions from the audience at that time. Please feel free to post your questions. I can't see any of it, so I assume the organizers will do it. But let's move ahead, and when I stop, I'll let you know. Okay. So there are two fundamental challenges that arise when you try to implement full duplex. The first challenge, and this was really a very hard challenge, is what's called the self-interference challenge. So by that, I mean the following. When you remember, in a full duplex system, the base station, for example, that's a cellular tower, can transmit and receive at the same time. So when it transmits, a signal goes out. And what happens is you receive a copy of the signal you transmitted. Okay, so that copy interferes with whoever else you're trying to receive, interferes with the signal you're trying to receive. So for example, here node T is transmitting to the base station, and the base station is simultaneously transmitting to node R. So this is a full duplex base station. And now, because there is your own signal that is leaking back in, this red signal will interfere with the blue signal. So you'll essentially lose out on, for example, not be able to decode the blue signal. There are many reasons why this self-interference happens. One is external. By that, I mean you have a transmit antenna and a receive antenna. The signal from the transmit antenna goes out in the environment, gets bounced back, and gets reflected back. and can happen very quickly. The other is internal, which is your RF circuits itself. Some of the transmit signal can leak from your transmit side into your receive side. Or you have all the circuits put on a board. There's a signal that leaks through the board and arrives at the receiver circuitry. So the bottom line is, and this is really why this is a big deal, is there are isolation circuits that are always put in these systems to isolate the transmitter and receiver. But the key thing is the level of isolation that is possible is nowhere near enough to handle the kind of signals that leak into the system. So what I mean is the following, that when you transmit a signal, you're pumping out something like 10 watts, sometimes even more. And when you design your receivers, you're designing them to receive signals that are as weak as 10 nanowatts. These are very generic numbers. You know, I could be off by a factor of 10, but this gives you a ballpark idea of what we're looking at. So we're looking at essentially a 10 power 9 or in like, that's why we measure everything in dB. It's so much easier to say 90 dB, 10 log 10 of 10 power 9. You have a 90 dB difference between the transmitted and received signals. And if your self-interference signal is, even if you attenuate it by a factor of 1,000, you know, by 10,000, by 1,000,000, it is still far, far stronger than what you would receive. And therefore, it will essentially swamp out what you receive. So you just can't receive. So what you need to do to make full duplex happen is do self-interference cancellation. And that is, I can get that self-interference down by a factor of 90 dB, by 90 dB, a factor of 1,000,000,000,000. Okay, that's how much accurate your circuits need to be to make this happen. Okay, so it was a very, very difficult challenge for several years. But in the last 10 years, people have now figured out how to do this. There's some very exciting work by several groups in Rice University, UCSB, and so on, where they've shown that by doing a series of smart things, it is now possible to achieve this 90 dB, 100 dB self-interference cancellation. And it is not one single trick, it's a sequence of tricks. So what they do is, I'll walk you through this a little bit. They use multi-stage hardware and software algorithms. And they're broadly three stages. One is what's called the antenna cancellation or isolation. So in this figure, which I've borrowed from this paper, this is the transmit chain. So this is the signal is coming and going out of the transmitter here, and this is the receive chain. So you would receive your signal from here. Okay, and hopefully not this fellow you're pumping out, but from somebody else. So the first thing they do is they isolate the transmitter and receive antennas as much as they can. For example, they space them half a wavelength apart. They put isolating materials or insulation materials and to minimize how much signal conductance is there between these two. First thing. Second, but that's not enough. You get about 20 dB, 30 dB. You know, 20 dB is also a lot, a factor of 100, but nowhere near enough. So that's the first thing they do. Then they do RF cancellation, which means when the signal is going out of the transmitter, they tap a little bit of it. They attenuate it, of course, to the extent required. Essentially, they try to reproduce the propagation channel the signal would see and cancel it out from the received signal. So the received signal is coming here. You cancel out this transmitted signal from it, and therefore you've cut down or canceled out interference as much as possible. Okay, but this itself does a fantastic job, a factor of 30, 40 dB, but then if you get 20, 30 dB, another 30 dB, so you're getting 60 dB, still not there at 90 dB. So you need more tricks. And the last trick is done in digital baseband. I know what signal I'm transmitting. Therefore, I can essentially generate a copy of the signal that would leak through at the receiver and then cancel it out from the receive signal. Okay, so this is digital baseband cancellation. Some of these operations are also nonlinear, but broadly, these are the three things that are done. And by a combination of these, well-designed combination of these three stages, these groups have actually built prototypes and shown that you can now achieve 100 dB cancellation. Okay, so in a nutshell, what has happened is this major challenge has now been solved. That is why full duplex is now a practical reality, or will be a practical reality. And essentially, we've got self-interference down to the level of noise, which we know how to handle. So that's the story. Okay. But even if you've solved the self-interference problem, there are still new problems that arise. And this is the goal of my talk. Okay. So I'm not a circuit designer. I really don't know how to build those blocks. But I'm more of a wireless systems designer. So the point I'm going to make is, well, you get rid of self-interference, you still have a lot of things to figure out. Okay. So the new thing that happens is what I call cross-link interference. So here is a cartoon. I'm going to have lots of such cartoons throughout my talk. So this is the base station whose full duplex. This is a self-interference signal. Now we've managed to, you know, knock it off by 90 dB or so. So it's like a very weak signal now. Okay. Now the transmitter is transmitting to the base station. So we'll call this uplink. Think of, you know, you're looking up at the tower. And the base station is transmitting simultaneously because it's full duplex, and this is the downlink. So when the transmitter transmits, not only does its signal reach the base station, it will also go and reach the receiver. Okay. And therefore it now annoys the receiver, because the receiver is actually trying to receive the signal from the base station, but it's also getting an interfering signal from the transmitter. So this is cross-link interference. Now this cross-link interference is arising solely because the transmitter and receiver are on at the same time. In today's wireless systems, either the transmitters are on or the receivers are on, but both of them are never on at the same time in a cell. Now you're creating this possibility. You want to create this possibility in full duplex. And this creates interference, cross-link interference. And so even if self-interference is gone, you still have this new source of interference you have to worry about. Why is interference bad? Well, intuitively, what does interference do? It basically, essentially, it's more noise in a linear system. So your signal to interference plus noise ratio comes down. And lower your signal to interference plus noise ratio, the lower your data rates you can transmit. And if the SINR is really, really poor, well, you just have to stop transmitting. So it can really shut you down if you're not careful. Okay. Very good. So this is a good break point. If there are questions, I can take them before I go into what are the implications of cross-link interference in system design. If there are no questions, I request the organizer to tell me to move ahead, and I'll go ahead.
Hello, I'm Professor Rajesh Roy.
Yeah.
First of all, please accept my most respectful apology because I'm late. Because I had some hardware trouble, but I could fix that and I could join the meeting. I am supposed to be hosting this meeting, actually. I mean, coordinating this. So as you were asking the coordinator, so I mean, participation, and so I hereby, with your and Devotshri and others' permission, I participate. Yes, you can go ahead with the next phase of talks, because it looks like the students don't have any question at this stage, neither do I have.
All right, thank you.
So please go ahead, sir. Please go ahead.
Nilesh, Sudeep here. How are you? Sudeep Mishra. So what I see is there are some questions in the chat students have posted. I just wanted to point you to those.
If you can read them out for me, I'll be great, because all I'm seeing is my PPT slides.
Oh, I see. Okay. So can someone student organize?
Some question, I think. Barik.
Sir, there are three questions. I will read it out to you.
Yeah.
So the first question is, can you explain what do we mean by latency?
Okay, latency is essentially when you send a packet from the application layer, it goes through a whole bunch of layers, goes out of your transmitter, reaches the receiver, and then it goes back the entire protocol chain and then goes back essentially to the application layer at the receiver. There is a delay associated with the entire process. You know, there's a software delay associated with processing the packets at the different protocol layers. There's a propagation delay. Sometimes you might not even be allowed to transmit, so you have to wait. And then, of course, there's a receive chain delay. This whole end-to-end thing is essentially called latency, and you want this to be as less as possible. For file transfer applications, you don't particularly care because you're downloading a file, it's okay. But if you're gaming, then even milliseconds matter. And if you're in the financial market, microseconds matter. Yeah. Thanks.
Our next question is, are you assuming omnidirectional antennas at users and PAs? If we use directional antennas, the self-interference may be eliminated to some extent. Is it true?
Yes, it is absolutely true. If you use directional antennas, you can definitely orient nulls in some directions, and you can definitely reduce the complexity of the problem, but the magnitude of the problem. The problem doesn't go away because, A, you need perfect nulling. Second, you also have side lobes, which you have to worry about. I'm showing only two users. Now imagine there are many more users. Then the problem still is. But it does help. That's absolutely right. Yeah.
Okay, so thank you. So the next question is, how will it work in a decentralized network?
That's the second part of the talk. Hold on. Okay, let's move ahead.
Yes, okay. Another question is there from Devoshi Basu. He is saying, sir, can you kindly tell that for small or micro cell 5G architecture, which type of interference dominates most? Is it self or cross-layer interference?
Wait for my results and you'll see the answer.
Very nice. Okay, sir. Very nice. So hold on for a second, so we'll tell all of this.
Very nice. Okay, let's move ahead. Thank you very much for your questions. Keep them coming. I have half an hour. We'll comfortably finish. So do ask your questions. Okay. So to understand the implications of full duplex, or the implications of the interference that comes because of full duplex, does it completely negate, for example, this potential doubling of spectral efficiency, or can I still do better? Okay, that's the question we want to understand. So to understand that, I'm going to show you two models. We have to understand in the context of these two models. I'm going to simplify throughout my talk just so that we get the basics in. So there are two models. One is what's called the bidirectional model, where you have a full duplex base station talking to a full duplex user. So both of these guys are full duplex. Therefore, they can talk, uplink and downlink at the same time. No problem. It's kind of like a point-to-point system, except more fancy. The other is an asymmetric model. This is the real model I'm going to focus on in this talk, where essentially you've got a full duplex base station but half duplex users. Okay, so you have a half duplex transmitter who can only transmit or receive. In this case, he's transmitting, and a half duplex receiver. Now, the reason why I'm focusing on the asymmetric model is first that this is really the model that's going to be practically most likely the practical deployment model, because full duplex is non-trivial to implement. I showed you, for example, the multi-step architecture required to pull it off. It makes the hardware expensive. When you've got a $50,000 base station, you can throw money at the problem. When you've got yourself a $10 chipset, you can't throw money at the problem. So that's why I'm going to focus on the asymmetric problem, asymmetric model first. Okay, so this is the cartoon you're going to see again and again in the rest of the slides. Okay? Very good. So now I've tried to minimize the number of equations in my slides, but at the end of the day, I'm an engineer. So there are a few things I'm going to convey, but hopefully not much. And it is important to understand it physically, what's happening. Physics matter. So let's understand what the implications of cross-link interference are. And what I've done is shown here two things. One is the signal to interference plus noise ratio if you were just doing half duplex. The other is the signal to interference plus noise ratio if you did full duplex. And let's see what the difference is. So I'm going to show it in the context of this cartoon. This is a full duplex base station. This is the transmitting user, U for uplink, D for downlink. Downlink means receive. So when the uplink user transmits with a power PUE, he generates a cross-link interference of PUE times whatever the channel gain is. So this channel gain is shown by G. So now let's look at the downlink SINR. So at the user, what is the signal to noise ratio? So if the base station is transmitting with a power P, BS, this is the channel gain, this is the signal strength, power into channel gain, divided by the noise at the receiver and interference. In this case, half duplex, you have no cross-link interference. User is not even transmitting. So the only source of interference is interference from other cells, from interfering base stations nearby. I'll call that co-channel interference, CCI. Okay, so essentially you have only this and this. With full duplex, now you have this additional cross-link interference. So your signal strength remains the same, but in your denominator, not only do you have co-channel interference and noise, but you also have cross-link interference. So you can see now, depending on how strong this cross-link interference is, your SINR can change quite a lot. If it's very strong, like if, for example, it dominates the co-channel interference, we'll have a much weaker SINR than half duplex. So yes, I get to transmit and receive at the same time, but the rates I'll be getting are very lousy. So it's almost like, why bother? Okay. And it is this additional interference that arises, and it is this interference that forces you to, you know, revisit system design. Okay. And if you're not careful, full duplex can actually be injurious to health. I mean, essentially system performance. Okay. So it's this we need to control. So how do we control cross interference? Well, that's the question we need to answer clearly. So well, the answer is, you know, intuitive and obvious. Be very careful about who gets to transmit and who gets to receive. For example, if you take this picture physically, you know, in a literal sense, users 1 and N are far apart. So if 1 transmits, it's likely that this cross-link interference is going to be very weak when N receives. If 2 and 3 transmit, then most likely 2 is going to harass 3 a lot because he's going to generate a lot of interference. So you need to be very careful about which users you pair, which users you schedule. Okay, very simple. Okay, so what's the problem with that? Why have we not done? The problem is the base station is the person who's scheduling. Remember, in a cellular system, base station is God. He decides everything. So the base station does not know this cross-link interference. You can see it's not even part of the link. When 2 transmits, 3 receives. How the hell is the base station supposed to know what the cross-link interference is? Well, how do we solve this problem? You can say, well, you know what? Okay, base station needs to schedule. He doesn't know what the cross-link interference is. So I'm going to make the user 3 or every user feedback to the base station the cross-link interference it sees. Okay? So now the base station can measure the cross-link interference, plug it into that SINR formula, and then decide, hey, am I seeing a good SINR or a bad SINR? If I see good SINR, I'll pair those users. Otherwise, I won't do it. Very simple. What's the catch? There's always a catch. Is if you look at the number of user pairs, you know, there are n users, you have n choose 2 user pairs, and n choose 2 is order n square. So the feedback overhead that you incur in feeding back cross-link interference or some, you know, quantized version of it is order n square. Cellular systems are designed to handle order n feedback, and even there they cry, they groan, they do all sorts of things to cut that feedback overhead down. Order n square, the system is just going to collapse. Okay, it's like a government bureaucracy that takes over, and nothing's going to happen after that. Okay, so we need to solve this problem. So fundamentally, there are two problems that arise. Okay, this is the system redesign I was talking about. First, you need an efficient algorithm. Efficient meaning gives you high throughput for pairing users. And in some cases, even choosing the mode. Sometimes it's better off to just give up on full duplex, go half duplex if cross-link interference is too strong. So we need user pair scheduling and mode selection algorithm. But before that, you also need a feedback scheme that has very low overhead. You know, the more you've cut back on feedback overhead, the more the performance loss intuitively. But you don't want it to just mess up your performance a lot. Ideally, you want to know all the channel gains in the system, but that's not going to happen. Okay. And the last thing, and this is where Ramakiran comes in, that's where you get a PhD for, is after all this, after you proposed a feedback scheme, after you designed algorithms, tell me at the end of the day, how much does full duplex buy me? Okay, so what is the performance of the system? Okay, so let's look at this. Before I do that, I forgot to mention one thing, that's why I have this slide. There's also one more thing, issue if you think about this problem a little bit more deeply. What did I say? I said you have to feedback cross-link interference. Fine. But cross-link interference from whom? There are n minus one other users. At the time of generating feedback, I don't know which other user will be scheduled with me. So if user D is feeding back to the base station the cross-link interference, he has to feedback cross-link interference from every possible user U. Okay, it's a lot of potential users whose cross-link interference needs to be fed back. Okay, so for calculating downlink SINR, this cross-link interference is not just is an unknown. And it affects the performance. So we somehow have to have a handle on it, even though I don't know who my user who will be scheduled with me will be. For uplink SINR, uplink means the user is transmitting, base station is receiving. This issue doesn't arise. There is no cross-link interference because the interference at the base station is coming from other base stations, like in a classical cellular system. No issue. Same as before. Uplink doesn't change. It's a downlink that changes because of cross-link interference. Okay. So here's the proposal. This is what we did. We came up with a low feedback scheme, and I'm just going to give you the high level picture. Yeah, I'm not going to go into detail details of the scheme, but hopefully you'll get an intuition for the scheme and also appreciate why you would expect it to work. Okay, so the scheme is as follows. Let's say one of the users has been selected. What it does is it feeds back to the base station all the users who have a weak cross-link interference to it. Okay, what do I mean by weak? So the interference power must be below a threshold, gamma subscript TH. So I'm going to call it the cross-link interference threshold. So you can see now this cross-link interference threshold is a very important system parameter. You can kind of guess. If you choose a very large threshold, that means you have a weaker SINR, you have a lower SINR, because you're allowing stronger interferers to be fed back. But the advantage is there are many more users who can potentially be fed back. Okay, so this circle in a way enlarges as the cross-link interference threshold increases. But if you choose a very conservative cross-link interference, say I'm not going to tolerate anything that is strong, then yes, you have a stronger SINR, but then you have fewer users who you feedback. Okay, so maybe you'll say, hey, there's nobody who's so weak that I can tell you about him. That's what the user is going to tell the base station. So it's a very critical parameter you need to choose. And if I do have many, many users, I'll cut them off at L. So my feedback bandwidth is limited. So at most L users, I'll feedback cross-link interference, no more. Okay, even if there are a million users, I'll say no more than six, for example. Now, there's another advantage to this. I said I don't know what the SINR is when I feedback. But now, if I tell you that I'm going to only feedback weak enough users, I know that this is definitely less than the threshold, gamma TH. And therefore, I can now bound the entire SINR term and say it's greater than this value, where I've replaced the cross-link interference with the largest possible value it can take in the feedback set. And therefore, now I have an estimate of my downlink SINR, even though I don't know who my other user is going to be with me. And I can use this estimate for all my scheduling decisions, rate adaptation, and so on and so forth. Okay, so we've kind of solved two things, we've killed two birds with the one single stone. One is we've now got a control over feedback. We've got a control over also the cross-link interference, and therefore the downlink SINR. Okay, very good. So here's the scheme. Now, this is a very obvious intuitive algorithm. First, the base station chooses one of the users who will give it the highest rate, either uplink or downlink, based on the conservative estimate of SINR. Pick one. Once that user is selected, say I'm showing him his user F, which is 3 here, this user will feed back to the base station L other users, at most L other users, who have weak cross-link interference to it. Okay, weak is below a threshold. And among these, the base station will pick one of them and schedule it to transmit on the other link. Okay, so for example, if the base station is going to transmit to user F, is going to receive from user S. So here I'm showing user S as 5, for example. Sometimes the base station can say, hey man, this is too much. I'm not even going to do full duplex because even after all this effort, I'm getting a lousy rate. I'll just move to half duplex, no interference whatsoever. It's entirely possible. That's the mode selection and user selection algorithm, okay, in a nutshell. And after you come up with these algorithms, now you can actually analyze these algorithms. I'm not going to go over the analysis, but I do want to show you these because this is really where the understanding of the problem comes through. You can actually characterize how this threshold must be chosen. I remember I mentioned this threshold plays a very crucial role. you can actually analyze the system and show something. And this is a slightly advanced slide. So if you've not done a wireless course, you can close your eyes. But if you've done a wireless course and you've seen things like shadowing, fading, path loss, these terms, then you might be able to follow this slide. So for example, if you look at a channel model in which you only consider relay fading, small scale fading and path loss, which is signal decay over distance, turns out the threshold should decay as 1 over number of users power some number which is between 0 and 1. So think of, you know, half. So 1 over square root of n. Okay. So more the number of users, smaller the threshold. That's, you become more and more conservative. Because you have so many candidates, you can choose to, you know, increase your admission criteria. That's essentially the logic. But if you have also something called shadowing, shadowing occurs because the signal has to pass through buildings, people, trees, walls, and so on. That's an additional randomness in the channel. Turns out the statistics of the problem completely change, and the way you set your threshold is exponent of minus square root log n. Totally different math kicks in. But again, the moral of the story is as the number of users increases, you tighten up who you admit. And turns out, if you do this, you can guarantee or ensure that the feedback set will consist of L users with very high probability, probability approaching 1. So you're feeding, you're using the entire available feedback bandwidth, no more, feeding back as much as you're allowed to, no more, and using the what's called multi-user diversity to the fullest advantage. Okay. You can also analyze what is the net throughput of the system. I'm completely ruining the algorithms, the formulae. If Ramakiran looks at it, it's going to cringe. But this, in a nutshell, gives you the broad thing about what's happening. So you can actually analyze the system and characterize the sum throughput, uplink plus downlink. You know, the idea was full duplex is supposed to double it. Does it really double it? So we can actually derive formulae like this. The capacity is something that's a function of the feedback bandwidth plus some constant times log of the number of users. If you've not seen this log and stuff, it might look a little alien to you. But these are very, very natural things that arise in this kind of scheduling system. This is the output of a greedy scheduler. If you account for shadowing, the dynamics of the system completely change. The scaling laws, rather. Dynamics is the wrong word. Scaling laws change. It scales in a very different manner. But the key point that our analysis showed was that these scaling laws are exactly the same as in a half-duplex system. You know, I've been saying full duplex is wonderful, it doubles the throughput, all that is nice. Bottom line is it doesn't change the scaling law. All it does is it changes these constants. These constants increase a little bit. And that's where the gains of full duplex come from, not by fundamentally altering the scaling laws of the system. Okay, enough of math. Let's look at results. So one of the questions was, you know, which is dominant, which is not. So these results will in a way answer it. So what I'm showing here is the spectral efficiency. Spectral efficiency is measured in bits per second per hertz. How many, you know, essentially, you know, 1 megabit per second per hertz. So you're not cheating in terms of bandwidth. As a function of the self-interference suppression factor. Okay, so larger the self-interference suppression, the weaker the self-interference. So here I'm showing for 85 dB, and this is for 130 dB. You can see when you're, and I'm showing results for two channel models. One is for the red channel model, and one is for the blue channel model. Okay, so I'm not even going to tell you what the models are. You can look at it in the legend. Bottom line is, as you cancel the self-interference more and more, as you suppress it more and more, if you had suppressed it completely, this will be infinity. Okay, if you don't do anything in life, it will be zero. This is in dB scale, yeah, because of the sheer numbers involved. So you can see as the self-interference suppression factor increases, you're suppressing self-interference more, your spectral efficiency starts increasing. So this is essentially a half-duplex system. As you suppress more, something around like 100 dB plus, you start seeing gains from full duplex. Before that, full duplex is useless. Don't even try it. But once you can suppress it enough, 110 dB-ish, then you start seeing benefits from full duplex. Okay. Another thing I want to point out, look at the numbers on the y-axis. 9.4, 11.0. It is not 9.4, 18.8. Okay. So full duplex can increase the spectral efficiency. 10%, 20%, 25%, that's non-trivial, those increases. But it doesn't double it once you account for cross-link interference, once you account for feedback limitations. Okay, so when you do system design, you have to worry about all of this. What is the net benefit I get? This kind of answers that. And you can also see the channel model has a very significant influence on the performance. It'll be very system and environment-specific results. Okay, I'm going to skip this for want of time, and I'll move to decentralized systems. That's essentially the question that was asked. And then the decentralized system I'm going to look at is a Wi-Fi Mac system. But before that, I can stop for 2-3 minutes for questions.
So till now, no new questions are there.
No problem. Okay, let's go ahead then. So I'm going to look at Wi-Fi Mac and look at how full duplex works here. Okay, so I have a couple of primer slides because I'm not sure how many people are familiar with Wi-Fi Macs. I'm going to give you the basic idea, and then we'll get into the design problem with full duplex. So I'm going to look at the 802.11 family, I mean the family that we all use without even knowing it nowadays. And that has a distributed access system. In a cellular system, base station is God. Base station tells the user when to transmit, when to receive, and so on and so forth. Wi-Fi is much more random, or much more distributed, that's a better word. Users decide when to access, subject to some be nice to others rules. Okay, and the be nice to other rule is essentially what's called carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance, CSMA-CA. And it's also called the listen before talk protocol. The intuition is very simple, or the philosophy is very simple. Before I access the channel, when I have a packet, I access the channel. But before I do that, I will first listen to the channel. If the channel is busy, if I hear signals in the so a strong enough signal power, I will shut up. I will not transmit. Only when the channel is empty will I venture to transmit my packet. Now, if you think about it, full duplex is all about making multiple users transmit simultaneously. Whereas the CSMA-CA protocol is saying only one user should transmit. When the second user should come on, he should shut up because he's seeing the channel is busy. So you can see, in a way, full duplex is getting prevented by CSMA-CA. Okay, so unless you redesign your Wi-Fi Mac, you're not going to be able to leverage full duplex.
Richita, are you able to hear? I am not able to hear.
Yes, sir. I'm also not able to hear, sir. Maybe it's a network problem for our side.
Hi.
Okay. Yes, sir. Sorry.
When do you want me to stop? 5:05 or 4:55?
It's okay, sir. You can continue.
Okay, I shall try to stop at 5 o'clock, and then we'll have time for questions.
Okay, sir.
Make it more interactive. So 10 more minutes to go. Very good. So here's the basic idea of the Wi-Fi Mac. I'm not showing several concepts, but I think the basic concept will come through. The way it works is every user chooses a backoff timer that is drawn with uniform probability from an interval 1 to CW. CW stands for contention window. Okay, so think of CW as 32 or 64 or 128. So you draw a number with uniform probability 1 to 32, you pick one, and that's your timer. And in every slot that's 20 microseconds long, you decrement your timer by 1 if you sense the channel to be idle. However, moment you sense the channel to be busy, you freeze your timer. Okay, you just stop till the channel becomes empty. And then once the channel becomes empty, you start decrementing again. How long do you keep decrementing? Till your timer hits zero. Once the timer becomes zero, boom, you transmit your packet. It's as simple as that. And once you start transmitting your packet, other nodes will sense the packet and then they'll shut up. So they'll freeze the timers. That's basically the philosophy of what's called the distributed coordination function of 802.11 DCF. Okay, so this figure shows it. Say A wants to transmit a packet to the access point. So initially everybody the timer, they're decrementing the timers. Now A's timer has hit zero. Immediately, or rather it'll wait for some time. I'm not showing you how much it'll wait. There are diffs and sifs and all sorts of things. I don't want to get into that.
So but sorry for interrupting. We have one question I just want to ask. It yeah. comes from the YouTube channel. So yeah. Said that, sir, based on which parameter the feedback set value AL has been selected?
Yeah, so it is a system parameter. It depends on how rich you are on the feedback channel. If you have a lot of bandwidth on the feedback channel, which is also typically the uplink, you would choose L to be large because you really do want to know as much as you can. But if you're really poor or your feedback channel is overwhelmed, you'll choose a small L. So there's really no answer for it. It depends on how resource rich you are. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Please continue.
All right. So in this cartoon, so all three users are backing off, and now user A's timer has expired or hit zero. So now it will transmit its packet. So it's shown in green. And the AP will receive the packet. AP stands for access point. And once it's fully received the packet, decoded it, will send an ACK to node A, and node A is happy. So then after the ACK is sent, all the users restart their backoff timers. And now, for example, in this cartoon, node B's timer expires, and then it transmits its packet. Okay, so this is how the cycle continues. So you can notice here, there's only one green packet at any point in time, because it's a conventional half duplex system. Now, things can go wrong, because distributed access, this is what will happen, has to happen. It can happen two timers expire at the same time. So I'm showing here node A and node B, their timers expire at the same time. both will fire off packets, because the both, when they transmitted the packets, the channel was empty for them. Both transmit their packets. Now at the AP, you receive packet one plus packet two, and essentially every packet, this packet will interfere with this packet and vice versa. So the AP basically can't make sense of it. It's garbled. So the AP basically doesn't make sense of it, and he doesn't send the ACK back. So both these nodes will eventually realize, oh, my packet failed because ACK didn't come. And then they'll again go into a backoff phase. And to avoid repeated collisions, this backoff window is doubled in Wi-Fi. So initially, if I had chosen a contention window of 32, now I'll double it and I'll make it 64. 64 will become 128 and so on. And next time, again, you reset your timers, you do your back down. In this case, now B is succeeding in this cartoon. Okay, so this is how CSMA/CA works in 802.11, broadly speaking. Now, there is a problem that arises, which has to do with hidden nodes. And hidden nodes will play a very important role in this talk. So I just do want to spend a little time on this. So it can, you know, the way this mechanism works or prevents collisions is when you listen to the channel, if the channel has become busy, you freeze your timer. And so the idea is, if B is listening to A's transmission, we are assuming that B can listen to A's transmission. What if there's some obstacle between A and B that prevents B from listening to A's transmission? So B will think the channel is not busy, empty. It starts transmitting. So at the receiver, actually B is interfering with A. Okay. So this is a collision. So because A is hidden from B and vice versa, if node B and A are hidden nodes, it can happen that you can have a lot of collisions. So, and collisions are a waste of resources, because these two time instances were wasted. Nothing happened. You're just wasting resources. So they pull your throughput down fundamentally. So how is this problem solved? There's an alternate mechanism based on request to send and clear to send, RTS, CTS. So the way it works is, instead of sending the big fat packet in the packet on the channel right away, you send a small, hey, can I send please request. That's your request to send. The AP says, yeah, sure, go ahead. Now when AP says, sure, go ahead, everybody else listens to that, yes, sure, go ahead, and shuts up. So node B will now shut up. It will not transmit once it hears CTS. So if you had a collision, you only now collided with a smaller RTS packet, not this big fat data packet. And once the CTS is sent out, everybody else is quiet. Node A can fire off its big fat packet to the AP. AP acts, and the problem is solved. So RTS, CTS is a mechanism used to solve hidden nodes. And hidden nodes can arise routinely. I'm sitting in one room, you're sitting in another room. You might not be able to hear because of the wall between us, the concrete walls. So now, how do we modify this protocol for full duplex while retaining its core? Why do I want to retain its core? The bottom line is very simple. The 802.11 MAC protocol is prevalent. It's everywhere. You just can't say, trash it. Let's start using a totally new protocol. People will not listen to you. So we want to use the Wi-Fi MAC protocol, its distributed nature, which is really what made it popular, while also making full duplex happen. How do we do that? So I'm going to use two properties, and I'm going to show them using cartoons that exploit the full duplex capability of the IP. So a little bit of signaling, but not too much. Okay. First is what's called the busy turn. So when, say, the AP is... So here's a cartoon. Node 5 wants to transmit to the AP. It sends an RTS. Can I please send a packet? The moment AP hears the RTS, it sends out a busy turn. It's just a busy turn. So it just, every other node, when it senses the channel, will sense it to be busy, and therefore just back off right away. And the AP is capable now of sending the busy tone while it is receiving, because it is full duplex. It doesn't have to wait for the RTS to end and then send the busy tone. It can send the busy tone literally as soon as it gets the RTS, or it knows it's the RTS. So you can use the full duplex capability of the AP to reduce collisions. That's the first thing we'll do in the Wi-Fi. So we'll introduce this notion of a full duplex busy turn. Second, so okay, but before that, let me give you a protocol view. These are the kind of timeline figures I've been showing. So here, node A wants to send a packet to the AP, so it sends a request to send. Moment it sees a request to send, the AP sends, hey, yeah, sure. So it fires off a full duplex busy turn. Because of this, node B will shut up, because it's, even though it's hidden from node A, it'll shut up right here, and then AP sends a CTS, and then A and AP can communicate with each other. So we're essentially preventing collisions earlier through the full duplex busy turn. Second idea, you can also do something more aggressive. So this is the case where a node wanted to transmit to the AP. Now I'm going to talk about a case where the AP wants to transmit a packet to a node. So in this cartoon, the AP wants to transmit a packet to node 5. Now when it's transmitting to node 5, it knows it is capable of receiving from some other node. It's a full duplex AP. So it actually not only tells 5, hey, can I transmit to you? It also tells node 2, hey, why don't you transmit to me? All at the same time, because it is a full duplex AP. Okay. So this is essentially it's triggering an uplink transmission, which would have been prohibited in the classical MAC protocol. Okay. I'm also showing you something. This figure I'm going to use in the subsequent slides. This is a physical view of the network. Physical meaning I'm actually kind of showing you the location of the nodes. And this is a graphical or a logical view of the network. So this shows the different nodes. And if the two nodes are connected by a line, it means that they can hear each other. They're not hidden from each other, which means if node one transmits, it will interfere with node two. But if node one and node six, you can see here, they are, if node one transmits, node six doesn't hear it. So node one and six are hidden from each other. That's the way you want to understand it. And you can see different nodes have different hidden nodes from them. The, each node has a different view of the network. This is what happens in practice. This is the AP. Okay, so here's how FDRTS will work. AP wants to send a packet to node A. It sends an RTS to node A. And immediately after sending the RTS, when it's receiving the CTS, because it's full duplex capable, it will fire off this full duplex request to send. And it sends it to node B, saying, hey, why don't you also transmit to me? So now what will happen is the node A, AP is transmitting to node A, and it's receiving from node B. So you're kind of doubling the utilization of the network. So you get beautiful double spectral efficiency here. But notice here, you don't get double spectral efficiency here. So you always lose. You never get double. You get close to double. Okay, so this is the idea. And now one thing I kind of alluded to in two slides back is the topology of the network matters. Different nodes see different hidden nodes. And what the this graph looks like will eventually determine the performance of the network. What do I mean performance? The throughput of the network. Okay. So keep that in mind because the next few slides will be topology specific. So this is called the network topology, who's connected to whom. Okay. This is a completely very extreme topology where all the nodes are hidden from each other. No node can hear any other node. This is a case where it's a non-homogeneous. Some nodes can hear. For example, two can hear almost everybody, whereas seven can hear only two. So this is kind of a mixed thing. And the other extreme cases where every node can hear every other node. So now, how much does full duplex buy me? So I'm plotting here the bandwidth normalized throughput, megabits per second per hertz. Again, so no cheating in terms of bandwidth. As a function of the packet length in number of slots, not bytes, okay? Because this is a more physical way. This is the case where your network is completely connected. Every node can hear every other node. If that is the case, there are no hidden nodes, then full duplex simply cannot happen because whenever a node transmits, you'll interfere with everybody else. So this is actually the half duplex case. Full duplex buys you nothing. This is the other extreme where every node is hidden from every other node. Okay, this graph. And you can see now full duplex is giving you close to double the throughput, like 0.8, 1.6. So in this case, full duplex is able to almost double the throughput. And this is the intermediate case, you know, everybody is hidden, here some are hidden or partially hidden. In this case, the performance will lie between these two. This graph shows that, okay? So the most important point I want to make is, and this is a counterintuitive thing. Typically, when you do Wi-Fi MAC design, hidden nodes are evil. You have to do RTS, CTS to solve the problem. But in full duplex, hidden nodes actually are beneficial. That's really when you can exploit the full duplex capability. So it changes your perspective of how you look at these MAC protocols. Okay, let me stop. I'm at 5 and almost wrap up now. So in summary, I hope I've convinced you full duplex is exciting because it has the potential to double the spectral efficiency and reduce latency. I've not spoken about latency as of now. In fact, we have a summer intern who's focusing on that aspect right now. But it has. It is definitely a 5G plus technology. And the critical problem of self-interference has now been solved. Therefore, full duplex can be done. It's not a fairy tale. But even then, there are new system design challenges like cross-interference, which force you to revisit the way you do full duplex. And the challenges are different depending on how centralized the system is. The solution is different in a centralized cellular system. Solution is very different in a decentralized Wi-Fi system. And the bottom line is this. If somebody tells you full duplex double system throughput, he's lying to you. It depends on the system parameter. Sometimes it can, sometimes it can't. And that's always the story in real life. Okay. So with that, I'm almost done. If you're more interested, you can look up the group website that is mentioned here. The students maintain it. It's up to date. These are the two papers. One is hot off the press, accepted just last month. The other appeared a year back. One of Ramakiran's talk on the cellular system is also there on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. You can access it through the website. So look at it for more details for the gory math. Okay, so with that, here's my closing slide and I can take questions. Before I close, a shameless sales pitch. Let me just tell you who we are. I spoke to you about full duplex, but in general, like was mentioned in the introduction, we work on wireless systems. And we look at the design of the systems, the modeling, performance analysis, and optimization of the systems, current and next generation wireless systems. There are a lot of people who work in the group, PhDs. We even have postdoc, one in fact from IIT Kharagpur CS, Samresh, who joined us just 2 months back. MTech research students and MTech students, in addition to summer interns, many summer interns, usually 2 to 3 come every summer, as well as project associates. And none of this is possible without money nowadays, and there are many people who've supported us, so I do mention them here. And with that, I can stop and take questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I agree with sir that full duplex is a very interesting topic after this talk, because there are participants, seems like participants are very much excited and they want to know more and want to listen more from you, sir, because there are so many comments that they are in Google Meet, also in YouTube and Facebook, that we want to know more, but due to the short timing constraint, we can't do that. So we are expecting when the pandemic will be over, we are expecting sir to our campus, and we'll listen live from sir. And sir, so I just want to take another question here. I can see that, sir, how these hidden nodes are created? Are they virtually created?
No, hidden nodes arise because of physical. So think of yourself. Think of, you know, say there are two users, A and B. User one is in room one. User two is in room two, and there's a thick wall between them. You know, like now the signal is.
Okay, I think some network problem is there. I will request all of the participants to stay with us, because there will be a short photograph sessions. We will take a group photo with everyone. So please stay with us to be a part of this session.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
So yeah, the wired network went down. All right. Yeah, go ahead, please.
Yes, sir. So that was the question, actually, that because our next question is, in case of full duplex, can slicing play a role in resolving the hidden and external problems? Hello.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All right. I'm back to my wired network. Yeah. So. So let me just answer the previous question. The answer is these are not virtual things. These happen because of physical things, like how strong the signal is between two nodes and between the AP. So hidden nodes are not a virtual entity. It depends on what your deployment is. Okay. Now coming to this question about slicing, can you repeat the question, please?
In case of full duplex, can slicing play a role in resolving the hidden and exposed terminal problems?
As far as I understand it, no. Because network slicing is a technique to essentially apportion the resources between different traffic slices or services. Whereas the notion of hidden nodes is, again, not a virtual notion. It's not something you construct. It's something that's given to you depending on where the users are. So think of hidden nodes as something that is inherent to the physical layer. Whereas network slicing is something that's happening at the higher layers, that's trying to deal with the physical layer limitations.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. Another question is the cross-link interference due to physical proximity of the receiver and transmitter?
Huh. So the answer is yes and no. This is a very classic wireless answer. I'll never tell you the full yes or full no. The reason is the following. Physical proximity, yes. The distance between two nodes does play a role. The closer the nodes are to each other, you'd expect them to interfere with each other strongly. Yes. But it's not just distance. There are many other things that happen in wireless. For example, I mentioned shadowing. If you have blockages between two users, even if the users are close to each other, they might not interfere with each other a lot. Okay. So it's not just physical proximity, but in general, the signal strength between two users, they are related or correlated to distance, but not fully correlated.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. So now we will do a little photo session. Sir, we want to take a group photo. So I request all the participants to please turn on your camera so that we can take a beautiful photo. Shukanya, I'm requesting Shukanya to take the photograph of us and tell okay. us when it's done. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. 1, 2, 3, start. Okay. Completed.
Done?
Thank you. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you all, and thank you to sir for joining us. Thank you to entire IEEE CSSBC IIT Kharagpur team. And sir, we are also glad to invite you in our session, and we are also expecting you again in our campus so that we can learn and hear from you again and again. So thank you so much, sir, for joining us, and I want to conclude the session here. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Bye, sir. Bye.